Hi class, it's Bill Berry with an introduction to Chapter 5, Functions. You'll note that we skipped a chapter and are moving forward, actually a couple, and talking about functions before we move back to talk about some of the other things. Why is that? Well, functions are the basic building blocks of more complex programs. You really can't write programs of any size, of any interest, without functions. So we might as well kind of jump in here and talk about them, and then we'll jump back and talk about some of the other chapters, and that'll make sense. So in this video, again, we can't cover everything in the chapter, but we want to talk briefly about the benefits of functions and what they are. Also, how can we think about taking a hard program and breaking it down into pieces, functional decomposition, top-down design, all of these things. How can we do that? We'll do a little example of that. And then talking about how to use functions with parameters and return values. So functions can take sort of inputs and give outputs, so how do those things work? We'll also talk about built-in modules, so how do you use the things that Python's provided that are outside the normal set of keywords, and then how you create your own. So lots of good stuff here, lots of good material. Let's jump in. First of all, what is a function? Well, a function is some code that lives separately. It is self-contained, and it has a name. So you can sort of set it aside, work on it as a separate entity, and then you can call it whenever you want it, and it will do its work. Python uses indentation for code, which is interesting. It's one of the few languages that uses indentation to describe things that pertain to blocks, so you're going to see that in a minute. But that's a sort of a side comment. But functions really simplify a main program, whereas if you got a complicated program and tried to just write it all as one big long list of commands, your program gets really complicated and long, and it's hard to sort of take in and understand at one time. So by writing functions, by separating things out into little separate blocks, it makes your main program really easy, because mostly you're just calling those blocks, and then the main program is a traffic cop, and it's really easy to see what it's doing. So good stuff to use functions. Another benefit is you can use the same code over and over by just calling it. We never want to copy code. Anytime you copy code and paste it into other places in the code, you've got to think about, is that the right thing to do? Because if I modify one, do I have to go modify the other one, and will I remember to do that? It's a great way to create bugs. So functions let us get away from that. They also allow for really focused testing, because if you have a function that's supposed to do some important set of calculations, you can focus on testing that function. In fact, you can write some code to test that function by calling it over and over with different values and making sure that it gives the results that's expected. So that's a great way to focus our testing. They also help with top-down design. As I said, you take a big program and try to break it down into chunks that you can wrap your brain around. Top-down design is a way to do that, and functions are a way to solve that and put it into action. And last but not least, if you have a team that's working on a project, which you often will at a company, you can break it down by function. One person writes one function, another person writes another function. It's an easy way to break down work. So lots of benefits of functions, and they exist in all programming languages, so they're a fundamental building block we just have to really understand. So we're going to jump in and look at some more specific things now. So first of all, let's talk about functional decomposition or top-down design a little bit, and let's do an example using SmartArt. I love me some SmartArt. I worked on this on the Word team, and so this is a fun thing to use. So let's say we have a really big complicated problem, like we're going to do payroll for an entire company. The process might feel overwhelming, and one of the ways to get unoverwhelmed is to do a breakdown, a hierarchy chart of what we need to do. So let's use SmartArt to kind of make our hierarchy. So let's say at the top, I'm just going to say payroll. So I need to do payroll, and then now I think about what I need to do to make that happen. Well, first of all, let's say I need to get the data, right? To get the data about wages and whatever, right? So employee data. What else do I need to do? I need to calculate payroll, right? Then I need to print the checks, and I need to print a report. So that's my first level of breakdown, right? That's a very big overview of what the process is going to be. But now I can come in and I can break those into more pieces. So for instance, I want to get hours, and I need to also get wage, right? So I need to make sure I get the hours that the employee worked and figure out what their wage is supposed to be. Within calculating payroll, that one's kind of complicated. So gosh, I need to calculate the gross pay. I need to calculate the withholding. I need to calculate Social Security, and I need to calculate the net pay. So as you see here, and I'll just click away, and as you see here, we are taking a big problem and breaking it down into small problems. Now, the thing that we want to understand is that we could then move forward by making all of these, each of these little blocks becomes a function. And by doing that, we separate the work out, we break it into chunks that we can wrap our brain around. It's really kind of an amazing way to get started, and this is a great way to do it. Functional decomposition or top-down design, and the result here is a hierarchy chart that you can then start taking and breaking those down into functions and then start coding. So great stuff. Now, once you have each of these functions, you might want to use the other tools at your disposal, flowcharts or pseudocode, but that's focused then at the function level because you've already figured out some chunks that make great sense. So great stuff. Hopefully that makes sense to you. Now, what is it that we can do with functions? Let's actually take a break and let's move over and talk about functions a little more specifically in the IDLE. Let's create our first function. The way that it works is you type the word def, you're defining a function, you then give it a name. The function names follow very similar patterns to variable names. So for instance, I'm going to say define a function called say hello. You're then going to have parentheses. All functions have parentheses. You've seen this with print, input, format. Functions have parentheses. So put a parenthesis, open and close parentheses, and then you put a colon. A colon in Python says, I'm about to give you a bunch of stuff that belongs with this. Then it's important to note that in Python, it knows what stuff belongs with it by indentation. So I'm going to hit tab, and then I'm going to put whatever code I need to have as part of the say hello. Right? So this is a very simple function. I'm going to hit enter on or hit backspace to get rid of it. And I have now created a function called say hello. I'm going to save that, easy enough. Now, I haven't used the function. It's not going to run and actually do something useful, but it exists and it is ready for me to use it. So how can I use it? Well, in my main program, I just say, let's say I want to say hello. Again, always with parentheses, right? If it's a function, you have to use parentheses. So I now have a function definition called say hello, and I have a use of the function. I am calling it into action by calling say hello. I'm going to run that by pressing F5. The shell comes up. Sure enough, it says hello, as I asked it to do. So hooray, we've written our first function. Now let's make it a little more complicated and interesting. Let's say I want to print a little banner line here, right? So I'm going to print and blah, 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 blah. Hold down this and stop and there, okay? Now I'm going to copy that and paste that because maybe I want to print a second one as well. Now, anytime, as I mentioned earlier, that you copy and paste code, you always want to think about whether that was the right thing to do. We'll follow up on that in a minute. Let's make sure it works. Sure enough, it works. Great. Okay, so now let's say if the reason that we don't want to copy paste is, what if I want to go change one of these and add two more dashes? Well, I have to immediately come down and print some more, right? Add some more to the other one. Now, if this were off the screen and it was far away, I would forget to do that. So, and you might say, wow, this little banner line, it might be really useful to have elsewhere in my program. So let's actually break it out into its own function. Let's say we make a function called displayBanner. And I'm going to take the code here, and I'm going to copy it, and I'm going to paste it in here. And now I have a function called displayBanner that prints just the banner line. And now what can I do? Well, it is completely legal from inside one function to call another function. So now I have called from say hello display banner, and I've now not duplicated that code, just the call. So now I have one place, and if I decide to add or take away dashes, there's one place to do it and I won't forget. Now let's run that program. You see that the output is going to be the same, right? Everything is fine there. But now we have two functions, and we've called one function from another function, which is pretty cool. Now, of course, you know, we might want to say, well, we're actually not being very clever here. Why don't we use Python's built-in multiply, right? When you multiply a string, you basically get a repeated string, and that way if I want 65 of them, I just change the number. I don't have to go do that. And sure enough, that will work fine. I'll get 65 of those, and that's great. So that's a quick example of just how you write a very simple function, call the function, and in fact, call a function from another function. Don't forget the parentheses. They always need to be there. It's just the way functions work. All right, so back to our presentation. You can also have inputs and outputs from functions. These are called parameters when you receive them into a function, and they're called return values when you hand them back out of a function. The basic format is, inside the parentheses, you put all the stuff that you need to receive when the function is called, and then at the bottom of the function, typically, you say return, and you say what thing you're giving back as a result of the function. So let's write an example that uses dog ears and human ears. And so I'm going to erase this and start again and say we want to define a thing called dog ears. And into it, I want to pass human ears. Right? And we can call it anything we want. But inside this, in fact, let me go ahead and put that in here, human ears. Right? Now, how do I calculate dog ears given human ears? Well, I'm going to set up a variable called dyears, and I'm going to set it equal to the thing that I received when the program was called, human years, multiplied by 7, and then I'm going to return d years. Right, so now I have a function called dog years, which will calculate human years, or dog years, given human years. So how can I call it? Well, sure, I can say print, or I can make a new variable called, my age equals 29, yeah, right? And then I can say print my dog age equals my age, or I'm going to call the dog years function, and I'm going to pass it my age. And then I'm going to print my dog age. Right? So I'm going to save that, and if I don't have any errors, it's going to say I am 203 in dog years if I'm 29 years old. So you'll notice that this is called a parameter. It's data that is passed into the function, and this is the return value. Now, if you really want to be clever, you'll see that you don't have to really do this intermediate calculation, but there's a reason that I did it. You could just say return human years times 7 and be done. But let's leave this in here. The important thing I want you to note here is that this is a local variable. D years exists inside the function and nowhere else. So if, after I call dog years, what happens if I try to print D years? What's going to happen? Even if I spell it correctly, whatever, Python, if you save it and run it, Python's going to say, I've never heard of a thing called D years. Well, yeah, you did. You heard it up here. Yeah, but that's in the wrong context. One of the reasons that functions are great is because they are self-contained. You don't have to look outside of them for anything. Everything they need is inside of it. And, by the way, all the variables that you declare inside the function go away when you leave the function, which is what we want. Right? We don't want people messing with intermediate stuff. We want them to use the function. So this is an important point, is that functions have local variables. But this is a quick example of how you can call this thing. Now notice I'm doing all these calls at the bottom very step by step. So I can also do things, for instance, I can say print dog years of, and then call it with my age. Right, so you can put these in parentheses anywhere where you could print a value. You can call the function, it returns a value, and then it will print that value. So you don't have to do them all step by step, one variable at a time. You can put them and use them together like this. So that's a lot of concepts in a few minutes. That's a lot of small code, but kind of impactful code that we've written here. So hopefully that makes sense to you. You may want to rewind a little bit and watch it back. We have a lot of other things to cover here. But let's cover that. And well, actually, two more things. We can do this quick enough. So one other thing that you want to know is if you have a bunch of functions that are related, you can put them in a separate file, and they're called a module. And then you can use that module to very easily and bring in those functions. Now, Python has a bunch of these that are built in that are very useful. One is a random module, one is a math module, and it's easy to use them. All you have to do is say import and the name of the module, and then you can use its functions by saying module name, a dot, and then the function name. Let's do an example in here. Let's go back to our Hello World program. I'll sort of start again with this. And here's an example of that. If I say import math, right, I can then say print math dot, right? And if I type math and I type a dot, if you wait a second, it'll actually bring up some functions that you can use. So you can have a list. And I can see all the things I can do within the math module. And I can either start typing, or in this case, I can choose it. And then I'm going to do this, except I need to, it's a function call, so I need to say what I want to take the square root of. And when I press the second parentheses, it highlights the whole thing to remind me that I'm done. So now this is a valid program, and if I run it, it'll print 3, right? The square root of 9 is 3.03. So that's cool. Now, if I had not imported math, if I make that a comment and I try to run it, Python's going to say, no idea what math means. Well, okay, so let me take out the math and just try the square root part, right? It's going to say, I have no idea what square root means. So you really need all of this, right? You've got to import the thing, and then you can use the thing with module dot function name. You can do the exact same thing with your own code, which is the second last topic here, is you can just take all your functions and put them in a separate py file. You can import it by just saying import and then give the name of the py file, right? And then you can use those functions from your module by typing the module name, a dot, and then the name of the function that you created. So this gives you a lot of very powerful tools here. There's a lot in this video. There's a lot of implications, a lot of thought behind what this all means. So you might want to watch it again, watch the examples, read the examples on the slides, make sense of it all. And hopefully that's a nice little mini lecture to get you started with the chapter and understanding how you can use functions in really powerful ways. We will build on this, I promise, the whole rest of the quarter. And you'll be glad you invested properly in functions to understand them. Thanks for watching.